And you know what? I admire you guys for you guys are football. You got balls. You're trying something on for size. And I like to talk about all kinds of subjects, and I'm not afraid of who the audience is. I say what's on my mind. I throw the microphone back to you.
It's the Anybody Can Do This Show.
Yes, here we go again. Give you more, nothing lesser. Back on the mic is the anti-pressure.
Hey, dude, nephews, it's your boy, Neighbor Nick, and welcome to episode 165 of the Anybody Can Do This Show. As always, I am joined on the couch at HQ by semi-professional cleaning person, it appears, Yoga Ralph. Ralphie, how the hell are you?
I'm all right.
Just all right. You got a fresh haircut. We had a very exciting week last week to recap. We got a great guest coming up, but let's get into you first. Why are you just all right?
I'm all right.
Okay. All right. That was a good all right.
I'm a little sore.
Okay.
I'm a little sore.
I'm starting to realize that you use all right similar to how people like, you know how fuck is like very, it can be like a verb. It can be an adjective. Like all right for you has very different meanings. I feel like sometimes.
It gets me in the hot water with people sometimes.
Oh my God. What are you? Speaking of hot water.
I'm in trouble.
But, someone just texted you like.
I met someone's parents one time and we went to this restaurant that they fucking hyped up so much. Like, yeah, go to this Italian. And they were like, how was it? And I was like, it was all right. And then when I got in a fucking car for the ride home,
this person eviscerated you.
How dare you say that to my fucking mother? And I'm like, it's all right.
I mean, so yeah. I wouldn't
give it 5 stars, but I'm not giving it 1 star.
That had to be, right, yeah. I wouldn't be doing
if
my due diligence.
Here's how you know me, because if it was whack, I'd have been like, this was fucking garbage.
Yeah. I was going to say, you would not have held your tongue, I would not think. So, that had to be a romantic partner, and that couldn't have lasted long. Would you say that was...
We pushed it a while.
Okay, so that wasn't kind of like the beginning of the end right there, you not liking her family's favorite restaurant.
It's not that I didn't like it. It was all right.
That's why I am jamming you. I'm part of the problem.
It's no Rockaway, but it'll do. You know, it wasn't a Yoli's, but it'll do.
Okay, all right. Before we get off the absolute deep end here, which we got to introduce our guest this week. We are joined by radio personality, internet legend, former wrestler, competitive eater, Todd Double D DeFazio, coming here live in studio. Todd, we met Todd through how we meet most of people, Benny at Yoli's. He did an episode of one of his new latest shows, which I believe is Club Sandwich on the Oneberg Network at Yoli's when Yoli's dropped the Daddy Fat Stacks for the Polar Plunge. He said on camera, if we raised 10 grand, he'd show up and join us for the plunge along with Benny. And I'll be gosh darn damned, he's a man of his word. Todd showed up the first one in the parking lot after me and you and Narfy jumped with us and we started kicking him off. You jumped on one of his shows with some of his guys during the tailgate. Like it was, there was a whole nod. So we just had to get our paws on
I ended up on their live stream.
Yeah. Popping bottles.
They were probably like, fuck, that was a mistake.
You kept screaming, everybody gets laid in the pit, the one guy.
And everybody did get laid in the pit that night.
His one buddy, I saw a quick clip, was like, I don't know what that means, but yeah. Which I thought was like, this guy and me are kindred souls right here, because I just laugh. I just don't get half the references sometimes. But no, we do. Todd's coming in here. We actually haven't sat down with him yet. Usually we do the intro kind of after we have the guest, but yeah. Todd's coming in. We got a little, like we said, competitive eater. Not only a competitive eater,
He told me he got a world record in Oreos, and I'm very interested.
I think Oreos, peanut butter. There was obviously two other things on there.
A lot of peanut butter.
And he's, like I said, host of
I can eat a lot of Oreos, so I'm very curious about what a record Oreo is.
I was about to say, and I like want to ask him, like, you know, like when you're a kid and you drink like shitty vodka with like red Gatorade and you can never drink red Gatorade again because
there's gotta be something he just won't eat in
the wild, right?
Well, I got a lot of questions about what the next day is like after you conquer a food challenge. Like
it's gotta be tough coming out.
I can only imagine the fucking toilet paper you run through the next morning.
So you thought your nephew was a toilet crusher, man. Yeah. Good thing he wasn't a competitive eater. So Todd's going to jump on. We're going to do a sit down. We're going to do beat or beat those cheeks, which we haven't done in a while. So it's going to be a good old fashioned shindig. Other than that, Ralphie, we're kind of coming down. excuse me, from the Polar Plunge high of world record 12 grand. We just, but I guess we should talk about extra day, right? We hyped it up last week. We finally got to be lucky enough to experience the Narfs and Chef's Matt's extra day downstairs on Thursday last week. I loved it. Thought it was great.
Yeah.
The movie, the dinner, the whole thing. I texted Chef. I think I take for granted sometimes how skilled and how much experience he has, because like that was one of the finer meals I've ever had.
Yeah, it was really good.
Yeah, and we're just lucky that he's just kind of our homie, always in our orbit.
That was a good time. The Narfs had me weak with a lot of the little intricate details, like the tarot card plates. And after you left, I stuck around and was reading civilians' plates downstairs. They're like, what the fuck does this mean? And I'm like,
were you charging?
No, I could have, but
you should have.
Yeah. Well, no, I told them what they didn't want to fucking hear though.
What does that mean?
I told them what the cards represented, and I'm like, you know, I can't help it if you got the devil. Like, you're restricted.
Somebody just came looking for some
I asked the lady, I was like, do you feel like restricted in life, like work, or and we got to talking, and I was like, well, there you go. It's not the worst card.
She left satisfied?
She probably went home and left her fucking husband.
Oh, my God. That's amazing.
And Brandon's card was like the moon, and I immediately was thinking about it. Like, I was like, that's very fitting for him. And then I believe Abby's was the sun. Yours was the tower.
What's the tower mean?
Tower's not a hot card, but that means it's like everything's crashing down. I don't know. It's like new start, things like that.
That actually could be a good thing, hopefully, maybe in a few
days. And mine was the High Priestess. And I asked Narf, I was like, did you give me that on purpose? I was like, when I get that High Priestess card, that means like summer of love type shit all the time. I'm like, did you set that up? And he was like, no. Yeah.
He did say that he let dealer's choice, I guess. He let the fish do the talking.
Yeah.
But no, that was dope. I got to get my paws on the movie because I couldn't watch the movie in its entirety. And then Saturday, you weren't able to go because of your workshop, but I pulled up on the one and only Skater Rob, former co-host of the show.
4 hours at Hips on Saturday, and I can't walk right now. Like, I don't know how I got up the steps. I hurt. I did one. I would have rather have been at Skater Rob's.
But no, so they set up in Lawrenceville, right outside Radio Skate Shop. He had a table out there. I grabbed a couple. I know the Narfs pulled up later than me. Chef happened to have the food truck down the street. It was a nice little Saturday. But yeah, you said you're recovering from some yoga work.
Hurting.
It's we're all coming back from being sick. The weather is finally turning, hopefully. Today, Monday, when we recorded, it was 70-ish.
I started feeling good on last week, finally. Like, all February was a blur I had some chest thing going on. I finally am able to, get out of breath without having, a coughing fit. I haven't gone for a run yet. I planned for a run. It was on my calendar. I just woke up this morning and I was like, you're not running nowhere.
Yeah.
Your legs are not going to cooperate.
Well, I told you, I walked the golf course 18 holes on Saturdays and woke up and my ankles were so sore. That's what it wasn't even really my legs, my joints, ankles and knees.
I lifted legs last week on Wednesday and I wasn't satisfied with it. I was having a bad gym day.
And that happens.
The next day I was like, my legs should hurt. Fuck, I ain't lift my legs for a month. I'm like, it should be killed. So I went back in there Saturday and did 200 squats with just 135. I was like, this is like some cardio. And then I was like, I'm going to go walk and go to the yoga thing.
Yeah.
Boy, as soon as
cooked. Yeah, yeah. You texted me.
I was 2 hours into it. These things always drum up funny emotions. The last two times they made me very angry. And
the workshops?
Yeah. And this time it made me angry again. But it wasn't like, it was me. I was mad at me. I'm yelling at myself in my head. I'm like, why are you fucking here? I'm like, this is stupid. Get up and just I'm like, Ralph, why do you get yourself in these situations?
You were
excited about this earlier this morning. Now you didn't eat enough weed. Like, you need to get the fuck out of here.
Oh my gosh. Oh my God. Speaking of, I don't know what just made me think, you were the guest on Croc Mode on Dr. Gold's podcast. So can I get that on silent for me? No, I'm just messing with you.
Check out the Croc Mode episode if you haven't already, live on the same platforms as us, Spotify,
YouTube,
iPhone.
Did you switch to Rumble, by the way? You heard of Rumble? It's like the new YouTube for free speech.
Is that where people are racist? Like, is that where people go to MAGA?
I haven't done my research
That where the MAGA people went?
Maybe, if so, redacted. Yeah.
I just don't know, we got to be on edge.
We're not going to
get
TikTok.
X now. Yeah, the artist formerly known as Twitter. I don't have a Twitter. I don't have TikTok. I don't have Snapchat. I don't have any of those. If it's up to me, I just rock with Instagram. And
we're also old as hell.
Yeah, YouTube's cool too.
I like YouTube. Yeah.
YouTube's enough.
Except for Tasia, we know you're out there still.
And there's always going to be a hater.
People always hate.
But if you haven't already, check out the Croc Mode. I realized halfway through that I don't like talking about myself for hours.
Like being on the other side. I mean, it was 3 hours. I was
a little under the weather still. You can hear it in my voice and shit. And I was sweating my ass off up in there.
Yeah.
I was like, oh man. And I just don't like talking about myself. An hour or so we could do that.
Yeah.
But I felt like, what am I even saying anymore?
Well, it made me think, it's funny you say that about being hot. I was like thinking today, it's like, we're getting very close to our summer sabbatical where it gets too hot to record episodes.
I've pitched numerous hustles to get this air conditioning.
You keep saying that at the plunge. He's like, now we raise money for the studio air conditioning.
I pitched hustles and they were all shot down to the point where it was like, I got 100 on it. You got 100 on it. We're just going to pay for it our fucking selves.
It's funny. Like a few weeks ago, I was walking through the north side when it was nice and there was like an old air conditioner out there and I sent a picture to Narf to see if we could install it. And then he kindly pointed out that it had scrap written all over it.
The thing with it is the window thing isn't going to work in here because the windows are crazy and the noise is going to be... like a window unit would be
too loud. You need to get an intern with like a giant palm leaf.
I thought you were going to say intern that worked for like Pusker heating and air.
No. We could
come down and be like, hey, why don't you take a screwdriver up on the roof and look at that for us?
Somebody like Mike D got to be able to like hook us up with some like bootleg air conditioning, I would think. Somebody around.
I know a dude that could, but I don't know about this roof though.
This is turning into like Seinfeld when he stole the cable and got arrested.
I had a homeboy that worked. I'm not going to say what housing authority you work for, but he worked for a housing authority and he would just take an air conditioner every once in a while and hook it up on his boy's crib.
Yeah, for a little side job.
And it was only like he would, if I told you how much people paid him, you'd be so sick. Like,
yeah. I would
like
love
$250
that.
Bucks.
Oh my God.
You provide the truck to pick it up.
Definitely don't give him my number. Yeah.
He does all my shit. All my shit.
Why wouldn't he? It sounds legit.
Anytime I knock on wood, my furnace been working. I got a new furnace not too long ago, but anytime I need furnace work, he'd be right
call
there
the plug.
Like, I'd be like, what do I owe? He'd be like, give me $12. I'd be like,
take me to sheets. All right, Ralphie, well, I think we should toss it over to Double D. You got any shameless plugs, things you need to go over before
I do some shameless plugs? Gongs last Saturday of the month, Tuesday yoga 9 a.m 6:15 p.m I will be in Shadyside a few times this month. I'll be there Thursday on the 21st and the 28th at 6 p.m. Pull up to that. That's my favorite class. I'm subbing for the homie Montana, who will be on here that same week I'm down there. She's not needing the day off because she's going to be partying with us, recording the day before or anything, but she won't be there the next day after we record.
Yeah.
I'm going to sub that for her and... other than that, shameless plug wise, I think that's it. Anything else in the hole?
We got some things coming up here in early summer, so stay tuned.
Yeah.
Next event, I guess.
Without any further ado, I bring to you Todd, Double D, DeFazio, world record holder for Oreos. We're gonna challenge him after this break.
Is that like a wrestling intro or a stutter?
I was trying to make it. Like, cool.
Yeah, I like it. It was very cool.
But it wasn't a stutter. I've only stuttered once, and it was captured on camera.
Yes. Yeah.
I hope it's captured on camera.
Go look it up. So what, first of all, I guess what made you decide that you wanted to build like a radio studio? Were you working 9 to 5s before went?
I have a career.
Okay. Regular.
And 9 to 5 still job. Yeah.
Like side hustle. I don't want to like diminish
it's
it.
It's like my dream, kind of keeping the dream alive while, you know, having kids and everything. You can't do that. It's like a young man's game. I'm an old guy.
And it's like, I mean, it's like you were saying, working out at the gym, you can't always get to the gym. That's why people put it in the house, right? So now you can do it. So when did you build all that?
So crazy how this all started, 2005-ish, everything started going nuts with Howard Stern. Me and my friends were huge Howard Stern fans, and he was going away. So he was going to Sirius. And I was like, I think we could do this. So me and my buddy started doing a podcast before there were podcasts. We had a CD subscription.
No way.
30 people subscribed at like, or 300 people subscribed at $10 a month.
No way.
And it was cool. We'd do like 3 hours a month.
On like a burn CD.
I had a CD burner. We'd mail them out.
That's fucking awesome. That is so dope.
Podcast.
And then out the trunk podcast.
And then technology, you know, came and everything changed.
What were you recording on back then?
Just a CD burner.
Yeah, just like you hook the mic right up into like the computer, basically.
I was a DJ at a bar.
Okay, all right. So you said some of the gear. We just hooked up, and then we were like a
Like a hybrid between Howard Stern and Jackass.
Okay. Well, and that's like, probably where like the fireworks stuff came in.
I watched that video earlier.
Yeah. I have like an insane pain tolerance.
Okay. Clearly, you just showed us two hernias.
My girl's bitching at me because
I think I've had one just complaining about it.
Yeah. But. As we started doing it, we were called the Village Idiots.
Yep.
And it was just like, we would do just crazy bits, like stuff now that TikTokers do that are making millions of dollars. We were years ahead of our time. I had a bunch of guys. I had a guy who's like 6'8 on my show. His name is Big Mike. And then I had like another guy who was like a basketball player. We'd March Madness. We'd throw a referee jersey on a shorter fellow, borderline midget guy.
Yep.
We'd go into like a Kogo's with a portable hoop and just start playing games. And stuff like that. And people would go nuts.
Everybody, I think, went through that, like kind of like in our generation, I'll call it. Like, I know my friends made a bootleg Jackass movie back in the day. Game changer for me. And so what? And then you just kind of parlayed all that stuff into like B94.
Anybody could be a producer. Like, there's
anybody
a lot.
Could do this, brother.
Yeah. You know, there's a million producers out there, a million radio guys out there, and I didn't have like this, like, you know, like really like FM, you know, like the super good
voice, silky voice.
Yeah. And so I was like, you know, let's just stand out. So I would, the crazier ideas that we'd come up with, and I was married to my first wife at the time, and she hated everything. So she was like the measuring stick. I'd be like, hey, I was thinking about going out and running a 40-yard dash in high heels and a dress. And she'd be like, that's the stupidest thing I ever heard. I was like, all right, that's
boys,
we
got a good one.
But she was like the measuring stick of what, like, if she hated it, we did it.
Yeah, right. Nice. You had your finger on the pulse.
The crazy stuff. So I was like, my dream was to be on the radio, you know, morning show host. And I got the opportunity to be on B94 by walking on thumbtacks.
Really?
Yeah.
No. So what? They were running like some like, dude, the craziest
April
stunt?
April 15th, tax day. And they were like, come up with something crazy. And I was like, tax for tax day.
Love that.
So that's where I came from. We built a relationship. My buddy Mud, who no longer does any of that stuff with me, he was the original Chubby Chocolate Leprechaun.
Okay.
Black guy.
Yep.
We dropped the rest of them like a leprechaun, and he was Chubby Chocolate Leprechaun 1.0, And then later on, when we became Idiot Radio, we had Howie D. Mack. He was about, I don't know, 4'8" guy, and he would, it was just insane.
Yeah.
I mean, people were paying us $1,000 to come really? To St. Patrick's Day parties and stuff, and he's no longer with us, but he was, I mean, I always think about him this time of year because of all the great yeah. stuff we did together.
Yeah.
Great, funny comedian. He was, he did like rap shows, like called Off the Grill, and just one of the like coolest people ever. But like chicks would love like rubbing on him.
Yeah, yeah. Kind of like Ralph.
We go
like,
to strip clubs.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
That's awesome. Ralphie, I know you wanted to get into the competitive eating.
I do. Yeah. I got so many off the wall competitive eating questions. Well, you hold a world record, right, for Oreos. Or a Guinness record?
The world records are all held on recordsetter.com. It used to be URDB, which Jimmy Fallon made famous.
Yeah.
And when I was at B94, one of the afternoon guy was like, hey, you should do some of this stuff. And they were like the dumbest, like crazy stupid world records, like most underpants put on in like 30 seconds.
Right, yeah.
Just so like it turned into a bit, and that's where World Record Monday came from on right. Star. And then in the meantime, there was an intern on the Flick at Night, which was like the night show at B94. He's a competitive eater, ranked in the tri-state area. So they would be like, all right, let's put the two fat guys against each other, and I would smoke them. And okay. I wasn't a competitive eater.
Right.
So I did like wing bowl, and then the world records became from World Record Monday. We would do, and they wanted them themed. So like if it was Peanut Butter Appreciation Day, we were eating a jar of peanut butter.
Right. So yeah. I saw you have like peanut butter Oreos.
Yeah, I did a jar of peanut butter, minute 40.
What? Like the big jar?
Like a regular size.
Okay,
like,
all right. With no like
water.
Cracker.
I used water.
But okay, all right. Still minute 40.
That's minute 40.
Nuts. That's nuts.
21 Oreos in a minute, and then what was the cupcake? 6 cupcakes in 42 seconds.
And most fireworks strapped to the human body.
Well, yeah, that was one.
Yeah.
That, it was weird because, like, if you Google, like, crazy world records, it comes up, like, in multiple sites and things.
Yeah.
But America's Got Talent called my wife looking for me. I made it so far, but I never made it to TV. I guess it wasn't like entertaining enough.
For the fireworks stuff is what you're talking about?
Yeah,
like that's
yeah,
what
yeah.
they were interested in? Really? Okay, that's great. So and like how many rounds did you go
15
through?
15 fireworks head to toe.
Wow.
And like we had to tone it down because it was on the radio. Like we were using like real ones, like Roman candles yeah. and stuff. And then when we were on the radio, we used the PA legal ones.
Okay.
So they were like glorified sparklers, but they just sounded loud and looked cool.
Hey man. Sell the sizzle, baby.
Hollywood.
A funny fact about that, Joaquin Wilde in WWE's on SmackDown was one of the guys that was lighting the fireworks when we set the world record.
No way. Nice. Just like happened to be in the crew. Like,
he was our intern at B94.
That's amazing.
But then we redid it with a machine where you were battery, like remote control firing. And like I was going to try like 30 at one point. But then I didn't get picked for TV.
So screw like, it. Yeah.
We're
yeah.
going to save us for something big.
Yeah.
So. That's insane. So we were talking before about the competitive eating stuff. You have to have, maybe you don't, some things that you've had a bad experience
never,
with competitive eating
never
and
do
you won't
again.
Eat now. Is there anything you like, you tried to do, like, will you not eat Oreos?
I have some things I don't eat.
Okay.
Like, I just,
but not because of food challenges.
Like Jello shots. Like when I turned 25, I think I did 65 of them.
Oh my
So like
God.
The sight of smell of like, I can't, yeah. I'll barf.
That's most people. I feel but, like
yeah.
bad Jello shots.
I just, hate Jello shots.
Yeah, me too.
On
How did those
shots.
Become? Whoever like made
Some
those become pop. Yes, right. Who didn't
Some
like
chick.
Booze? Yeah. Like, yeah.
It was an accident. I bet someone bumped a fucking bottle of gin. And
yeah, yeah. 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 When I was a kid, I remember like as a freshman, the seniors in high school used to do that with like gummy bears, like soak them in vodka
yeah.
overnight
yeah.
and then bring them to school. Like, oh, that would be brutal.
I did a 6-pound calzone and I yacked.
I was gonna. That was one of the imagine. Questions I was gonna ask because I watch a couple competitive eaters on YouTube. House things, and I always yeah. think about we've seen them eat, but we don't see a half hour down the road while they're driving home what life is like. What's that next morning like
the
after
only
a 6 pound
one that was
Kazem?
Really bad.
I figure a lot of people end up throwing up.
One of the world records I did was hush puppies. I ate, it was like 85 hush puppies in an hour. Or
that's
something.
Like fried cornmeal. Right?
Yeah, you
like,
give them a Long John Silver.
They're good, but not 85 good.
No. But like I shit sand for like a week.
Yeah. That's what, because we did a hot wing challenge downstairs here, like that show Hot Ones on YouTube.
Yeah, I've done a few of those.
You can buy like the 12 pack or whatever, and Chef Matt used to like sell tickets and basically come down.
They're doing that again, like in a couple weeks.
Oh, really?
I just seen it advertised for down there.
And I had to call off work the next day because I was just in so much pain.
I did it. I wasn't supposed to do it. I ended up in it. But I read on Reddit, like, if you eat a bunch of yogurt later on, you'll be all right. I ate a bunch of yogurt, woke up the next day, took one shit and was cool.
The hot stuff, I'll do it, like if it's a dare or whatever, but like, I don't know. It's a young man's game.
That's a young man's game. That fucks up your organs. That gotta go through. Your liver gotta process that.
Yeah, I did a challenge for publicity for the TV show a couple weeks ago. It was two foot long Italian hoagies and a pint of French fries in a half hour, and I got I'd say three of the four halves and all the fries, and I ran out of time.
Uh-oh.
I just couldn't get any more in.
Yeah, it's the speed
but
ones.
But when I was young, like, I always compared to, like, when you're in high school, like, remember carrying kegs when you were going to, like, party?
Yeah.
Like, now you try to pick up a keg, you're like, what the fuck?
You got
to
stretch for 20 minutes beforehand. Yeah, yeah. So, I guess, does any jump to mind, even when you were younger, like, food, rather records or whatever, that you underestimated, like you were like, this is going to be a cinch, and you ended up not getting it?
Well, that 6 pound cow.
Sure,
And that was the first time my wife ever saw me do anything like that.
Yeah.
And she's like cheering me on. She's like, come on, let's go. It was like 8 minutes in, and like I had this thing destroyed.
Yeah.
It was just like scraps, and then everything got stuck. And
just
I started
the,
like,
damn.
Bread's hard.
I didn't.
It's hard.
I started panicking. So I started chugging water, which was stupid. I should have stood up and moved around.
Yeah.
Like, got everything moving. And like she's sitting there and I'm chugging and chugging. And next thing you know, like I tried to burp and it was just like the Exorcist. I sprayed all over.
Oh, no.
Was that on camera?
Oh, yeah. There's a video.
Yeah.
I think I sent you guys. It's somewhere in that pack.
Really?
I didn't see it in there. I've tried the last 3 years to eat that big ass sandwich of Yoli's.
I want
to
try
that one that got away, and I could eat half of it no problem, and that's like more than enough to make an average person sick. But bread, so much bread, it just
stops. It's the cheese too, like in the calzone, like that just like expands once water hits it, and it's.
I don't know. I like all that stuff.
I watch them competitive motherfuckers. They be dunking it in water.
Yeah, I'm not a dunker.
Keep it soft.
Like, I'm a more, they call it picnic style or whatever. I don't dunk. I don't
like.
Have
you ever done like a red meat challenge?
I've done pizza. I've done burgers.
Well, I feel like I can mash.
I did
a couple
like a
burgers,
6 pound burger.
More than steak. Steaks, you got to chew the fuck out of. Steak.
I wish I could do like in the Great Outdoors.
I was just about to say 100 ounce. Like, yeah. I saw some, but there is like obviously there's got to be a place in Texas that does do something.
Yeah,
like
that'd
that.
Be cool to do something like that.
How's the far? Like, have you ever traveled to do any competitions like outside?
Like in like the general area, never like out of state or anything. I never took it that seriously. It was just kind of fun. There was a group of us. We'd do like Kennywood every year, and remember when ESPN they did a wing bowl?
Yeah, it was in Philly or something.
Well,
right?
They used to have one here.
Oh, really?
At Sports Rock Cafe.
I didn't know that.
And they would Junker and Crow, I think, were the hosts of it, and Louis Lips would be there.
Amazing.
Mark Madden, I think, came to a couple.
Of course, that sounds right up his alley.
And
it was
cool. Like everybody had wrestling entrances.
Love
like they
that.
Would wear costumes and stuff.
Just born too early, born too late, Ralph. That sounds right
I think
up your alley.
Please bring it back.
There was discussion about how many wings I could eat a year ago. It was huge controversy up here.
Yeah.
And I said I could eat, 80 wingdings?
So I don't remember.
I think
to be
I
honest,
threw out the number 80 wingdings. I went to Mulligan's 2 weeks ago, and I was still a little under the weather, but I ate four dozen and before I called it a night. I could have kept going. I could have sat there all fucking night. Well, but they would bring you six and they bring you another six. And I'm like, you slow me down. If you bring me 80 right now, I'm just gonna start
control off the leak.
Because they want your belly.
They let it sit and it fills you up. And I was drinking ginger ale with it. I never drink pop. I was like, I want a ginger ale.
We gotta bring this back, maybe. Maybe we'll talk about this off.
Yeah, like,
that's who Benny was here for that episode, and he's like, there's no way you're eating 80 wings. And I'm like, I don't know, maybe.
I do
think it's a lot of wings at the time. At the time I was bragging, I don't know if I could do 80.
That's a common occurrence around these parts.
In the qualifier, I did 125, and that was the highest, I think, in all of the because ESPN would do this for, like, months. They would start, and then March Madness would hit, and then they would have it, like, during March Madness.
You did 125 in how long?
It was, like, it was close to their call letters, so their call letters were 12:50. I think it was 12 minutes.
Wow.
So.
That's insane,
dude. Hold on. Wait.
That's, like, 10 wings a minute.
Wait,
like,
just run that back. You said 125. In 12 minutes.
Yeah.
Wingdings or whole wings?
Not whole wings. Okay. Just the regular wings.
But still.
No, you're bigger than wingdings. Yes.
Yeah, just the regular, still. Like the drum and
flat but still,
drum.
Yeah,
not
yeah,
connected.
But still,
what do you like better, flats or drums?
See, growing up, I was a drum person, but now in my old age, I kind of think I appreciate flats a lot more.
I like if I'm eating in a competition, I like the flats because. I do like
you
I don't
say there's a technique.
I rip them apart and I go boom boom.
Yeah,
and
it's done. Game over. Right,
it's done. But you with a drum, you gotta.
Yeah, you gotta.
Like eat like a piece of corn.
Yeah, see, that is so. It's just like the intricacies of stuff like that. You know what I mean? Is what blows my mind.
You just gotta have strategies to it.
Yeah, right. Like you don't get.
I watch these people eat and they'll eat. They'll save like
some of it.
The soft stuff for last. They'll eat the stuff that. Whenever it starts to get cold first.
Yeah, like eat, the cheese will coagulate or whatever.
They'll try to
like,
eat bread first because bread will harden and as you're chewing it, it'll start to fuck up the roof of your mouth after a while.
The jaw hurt. Like,
yeah,
doing that
that's what I was saying about steak. I could eat a lot of red meat, but if you put a time constraint on it, you got to really chew a steak. Yeah. You can't just swallow it whole. Like,
see, that's like even when you said like 21 Oreos in a minute, like off rip, that's like, that doesn't seem like a lot, but it's the... my jaw would fucking fail in 30 seconds. That's what I'm saying.
When you put a timer on and it's like...
The pressure. Like, like when you were talking about the calzone and like you're like panicking and you're like, I don't know what to do. Like, it's like, that's like anything else where they say like that tidal wave feeling, right?
I pictured the peanut butter jar and I'm like, that doesn't sound bad. If you put it in there, but you have to get that down your throat still. And
I just love peanut butter.
Like, if you ever give a dog peanut butter, they have a hard fucking time.
Even if you like in the middle of the night, go down there and scoop a...
I do that every night. That's my problem.
Oh, bro,
I love peanut butter. That's like
I need to get like a doggy gate at the top of my stairs.
I tried to do the Nutella one, and I couldn't even come close.
I was gonna say, have you noticed anything? Is like sweet harder than savory, or vice versa?
I don't know. I'm not a sweets guy.
Okay, all right.
Like,
so you pound chips and fries and stuff like that.
Yeah, wings, pizza. Yeah. I'm a pizza guy. Like. We did pizzas one time. It was like seven medium pizzas and like 15 minutes or something.
That's nuts.
And like the next day we had to go eat a 6-pound burger from this place from Century 3 Mall on B94 the next morning. And like I couldn't open my mouth. My jaw was so swollen and hurt. But I mean it's a sport. I mean, it's...
I was going to say, you got to train for it. You have to stretch your stomach to be able to handle all that.
There's guys I know that would do, like, drink gallons of water and then, like, let it just sit there overnight, and that would stretch their stomach out. And there was, like, a kid named, like, Brad Shula. He was, like, on Tosh.0.
Okay.
And, like, he did that Denny's Beer Barrel Pub Burger or something.
I'm not familiar.
Like, Tosh was kind of making fun of him. He was like, well, what would you be your ideal meal? And, like, they made him look like such a good.
Right.
Like, he was going to go in the ocean and eat a shark.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, what, dude? He's, like, making us look bad.
Yeah. So, and you were saying training. Like, would you, I mean, we haven't even touched on your wrestling and kind of all that stuff. Like, were you like lifting weights and like doing actual workouts like that for competitive eating? Or is
I was the guy that showed up and had fun.
That doesn't,
like, I'd crack jokes and
naturally
and
gifted.
Like, there was guys that would like take it like super serious. And like, I remember being down, I was like the regatta one year. They had like a wing contest, and like I'll come out with a terrible towel, get the crowd hype, and I'll do the Triple H water spit. And,
yeah,
you know, I'll do like crazy stuff, and then some guys, you know, they don't take it that serious, or they take it too serious.
Right? Yeah, yeah. Because again, it's like, even now with like the hot dog contest on ESPN and kind of all big, like, it's silly, right? Like yeah. That's what, like, it's fun. It's goofy.
Yeah, like,
it's
like they have it at Kennywood, Sugardale.
Okay.
Sugardale. It's a local company that Silver Star sponsors it. And, it's fun. Like, they don't take it too seriously.
You've done that one before?
Yeah. I'm not really good at, you know, dick-shaped foods.
Yeah, I was going to say, what's the Pittsburgh record for fucking hot dogs?
I've been in those contests, and there's two guys, Pete Maurizio and Bob. They call him Bob Killer Coons. The guy's probably about 120 pounds and has jaws like a bulldog.
No way.
It's always the small guys, too.
It's like that Kobayashi cat.
Yeah.
I've never
even come close to beating either one of those guys.
I watch a dude, his name's Beard vs. Food on YouTube, and he's so ripped at like 160 pounds, and then he'll eat a 32. Like, yeah. I once seen him eat 28 pounds of brisket, and I was like, I don't know how this is gonna end. Like,
but that guy says like he doesn't eat a lot off camera.
He'll fast for 7 days up in that. He said it goes by calories. He counts his calories weekly. So if he hits the weekly allotted in one challenge, you gotta eat salads and water all week.
That's insane, dude.
And that's being dedicated. He's probably getting a lot of views.
He gets paid. He's paid.
Yeah,
he's paid.
And then is that how Club Sandwich in Wernberg like all came to be? Was just like kind of just the next iteration of all this stuff?
Yeah, like, so like I just keep, as you can tell, I just keep throwing shit off the wall, and hopefully something's gonna stick.
Life.
Eventually.
That's
as
awesome.
As part of the Sandwich Club, what has been a sandwich that stuck out to you in your travels? Where should we start eating?
The top two from season one by far were the Daddy Fat Stacks.
Yeah, his sandwiches are unstoppable.
And Jameson's. They have this Stout and Straw burger. It was the best burger in Pittsburgh in like 2019, I think.
Where's Jameson's?
West Liberty and Dormont.
Okay, all right. I'm over there a lot.
Sure, what's good in the?
Yeah. They do like crazy, like all these crazy burger creations, like Frankenstein burgers, where he's just like putting, like making like a pizza on top.
Yeah,
like,
just wild.
Doing like all this wild stuff. And Jameson's a good dude, man. I've known him a long time. I've known Ben a good amount of time. And like when I was putting this together, it was like, those were the first two guys I called because I knew, you know, they were going to be solid, and those were the best two by far. Like, but I mean, everybody was good. We went to Aliquippa. We went to Two Chefs Catering. They did like a Kobe Bryant tribute sandwich.
Sick.
It was awesome. It was like a Italian chicken with like a ranch Italian
Mamba sauce or whatever.
Yeah, they call it dunk sauce. And it was just like, and I never thought like some like eating would like click, but it like hit.
Yeah, right.
Like,
yeah.
You know, like with my
algorithm so sick. I love watching it. Like, it amazes me.
With my job now, like, I had to tone it down. I can't do like smart jokes anymore.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You know, like all the crazy stuff we used to talk about. So, like, now I just kind of like, I just eat.
Yeah.
And Wernberg is my friend Brian, Brian Carruthers, Giant Brian from the old B94.
Yeah.
We're two old radio guys at heart, and he's like, I'm buying this social media site. It was like used like the penny saver. It was like they were putting like ads for like real estate, and it says 450,000 subscribers on it. Real people.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
It was no BS. And he was been working on it for about a year, and he came to me, and I was like, yeah, I'm in, man, whatever you need me to do. So we did, he's been putting so much time and money into it. But the first thing we worked together on was the Incline show, which was like the Letterman show on the Incline.
Awesome.
But you couldn't, disrupt the incline at all. Like, you had to get, like, if people were like barfing in front of you, yeah, or like running into, like, there's times like
I actually love the idea.
Run into the camera
that
or whatever.
Tom Green, yeah, shit.
That's amazing.
And it was awesome. Like, he dressed up in a suit and he's like 7 foot tall.
Yeah, he's at the tailgate, right? Yeah. Yeah.
And he's in a suit. We're doing a monologue in the lobby and the heater would kick on. We'd have to stop filming, or like some drunk guy would walk in and like we would keep that stuff. And then, like, we would just walk on. He would sit. I would pull with the camera. And, like, I'm not little.
Yeah,
I'm
right.
Running into shit. Like, I'm hitting poles and falling over. And
just cutting up, having fun.
But it was cool. Like, we had Scott Blasey from the Clarks on. We had Kurt Angle on.
That's no my way. White love, yeah. Kurt Angle.
He was awesome. He brought his whole family. And then we were talking afterwards, him and I, where we had there was like a cool moment where he like did like a little, my son Vinny Chooch, he's 8 years old. We call him the future champ of the world. Like, he just is a wrestler 24 hours a day. Like, he created this Chooch persona.
I love it.
And like, when I was training, he was training, and like, he was like into it. Like, he just, that's all he does.
My dad's nickname was Chooch.
Yeah.
That's funny.
It means, he always said it meant jackass in Italian.
Well, that's like what I've always
like,
heard.
I always thought the train, like the Chooch
is always just kind of
my,
that my fucking
mother-in-law
Chooch.
Hates that nickname for him, but I'm like, So he makes you smile. So like, it's a good.
Yeah, term. I like it. I called my boy.
Get him on here whenever before he becomes world champ. Yeah.
So we were talking about a couple friends of mine. We're talking about doing a documentary with him, like right now, and like film it until he's 18.
Yeah.
And watch him like his journey
through the amateur ranks. Dominating high school matches.
Like he's that into it that you he's gonna pursue it.
He has a belt, like we have belt, like he has his own belt, his Chooch belts, and
that's awesome.
Like he walked, I won my last match, he walked me to the ring, and he was supposed to be part of the finish, but he got a little nervous.
Little stage fright.
200 screaming people.
Now,
at 7 years old or whatever.
Now, how do you train to be a wrestler?
Oh, you got to go to a wrestling
school. Did you go somewhere locally?
Yeah, I trained in USCW, and then I got retrained by some friends of mine down the road, and then...
What is training like that consist of? Like 3 hours of just dropping on your back and running ropes?
It all depends on where you go. And some of these new schools are kind of soft, so to speak. But if you get to the right schools, like there's some real good schools right now. My buddy Dean Radford, he's running a school out in, I want to say it's Rise. And him and Brandon Kay run a school. And then... the teacher at PWX, Bad Boy Brian Anthony, he's a top-notch guy. Like, he's been on the road with, like, AJ Styles and, like, some big-name guys. And, like, I love the day I wrestled my last match, I got to be the promoter, and I was in, like, the semi-main event. Like, I was
awesome.
In the match before the main event. And it was, like, I got to be McMahon and Hogan in the same night. And like, he...
Book yourself the championship.
I just wrestled a match, and I was like a hardcore match, and just to hide my flaws. I mean, I can barely walk steps. My knees are gone, and you know, I can't jump around. Like
take a chair to the face, though.
But yeah, I like with the pain tolerance and working the crowd. It was fun. It was so fun.
Are those schools like around here?
Oh, there's a good bit of them.
They're teaching you, are you doing all physical stuff? Or they're also teaching you mic and crowd work stuff too?
Oh, you learn everything. It's a story, so to speak. You're telling a story. Like it's like a roller coaster ride, right? So like the hero comes out and the crowd's cheering for him, and then the villain does something and he might he starts beating up the hero, and then now it's going downhill. Now the hero's got to climb his way back up, and it's impossible odds. It's like
writing a movie.
It's just like
I love wrestling.
You're working a story, and if you got a guy that works a crowd and he can get heat as a bad guy and get over as a good guy. I mean, it's.
Were you a heel or a baby face?
I was a baby face.
Okay, all right. Yeah, I could tell you.
It was funny. The guy was my podcast partner. We were the official podcast of PWX.
Awesome.
And he went out, and like God, he always would lose. And I went out to help him one time, and I turned my back on him, and he beat the piss out of me. And then that's how that feud started. And it was funny. Like, he pepper sprayed me. We did a contract signing, and he pepper sprayed me.
This was at the church in McKeesport for a time, right?
The old.
And now it's at like Court Time, the old Court Time.
No, that's IWC. There's so much good wrestling.
I see flyers all the time.
IWC is for local
wrestling.
It's like going to like AEW. Like,
really? Yeah. It's that official.
They have Elias wrestling for them, and he started Elias there.
I told you I try to get Elias on here. I run into him all the time at Monroeville LA Fitness.
Oh yeah.
And I'd be like, walk with Elias, and I ask him all the time, "What you gonna do?" And he just, I don't know.
Wait, he's on AEW right now, this guy?
Well, no, he used to be in WWE.
He's doing IWC shows.
Got it.
Right now, because that's where he started.
Got it. Homecoming
there's
shows.
There's a lot of local
A lot of Pittsburgh ties to wrestling. Corey Graves.
Corey Graves, yep.
He's Sterling James Keenan from Pittsburgh.
Britt Baker girl, right?
Britt Baker. She comes to Yoga Flow.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. She still lives here. I guess because Ralphie's, I was never really big into wrestling as a kid. I've started to kind of learn it a little bit more as Ralph. So, like, when you're on the big tour and stuff like that, like, she's on, she lives here and then travels from here, or they're just on the road.
You only work like two nights a week.
Well, AEW's like a little different than WWE.
Oh, she's on AEW.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
I would assume that eventually she's going to make that jump.
They'll all end up there. All the good ones will end up there.
You know, eventually if they buy them, I mean.
So they're two separate companies, right?
Yeah.
Now. I always thought it was like the AAA to the WWF.
No, that's Major NXT. League.
Okay.
McMahon had his own farm league and all that.
Like, yeah.
That was his NXT. His own developmental.
And then there was like Ohio Valley still that was a part of it.
OVW, which is owned by Al Snow.
I never knew Al Snow owned that. And then I watched the shit on
that
Netflix.
That documentary was awesome.
It was actually pretty good. Yeah.
It was really good.
I saw that movie Iron Claw about the. Who are those old?
The Von Erichs.
And I never realized that, like, every state or couple states had their own.
That was
pre-WWF.
Yeah.
Right.
In the '80s, right? And then Vince
McMahon brought them all on the East Coast together.
Junior pissed at a lot of people off because it was run by mafias and things like that.
His dad told him not to do that, and he did it.
And he made it WWF mainstream.
Yeah.
And he stepped on these territories. Like, people in Pittsburgh may not have known who Ric Flair was. He may have come through once or twice a year with the NWA title and maybe fought like Zabisco or Bruno, Johnny DeFazio, somebody. You know, somebody famous.
So Bruno never really.
I was going to say, that's why Bruno Sammartino has that record for like 2,800 days as champion because he would just wrestle in Pittsburgh.
He was Vince's champion.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was WWF.
This has nothing to do with anything, really. It's kind of like tangentially related. I just saw this thing about like Jack Dempsey and Floyd Mayweather and how like Floyd Mayweather has 52 wins in 11 years and Jack Dempsey's was in 13 months. He had 52 wins in a year, which is crazy. He's fighting every week. Like, that, literally, like every week. Like, it's insane to think about some of that stuff. Like just how much physical and emotional stress all those guys went through because for just the glory of it. You know what I mean? Like, it's peanuts in terms of money, definitely a drug. Yeah.
I bet
200 and some people scream your name.
I have 30 people clap for me every week. And it's like, when they clap after class, I'd be all hype. Yeah. I can only imagine what 16,000 like would do to you in an arena.
So the yoga,
it make me fun.
I'm gonna turn on you guys. The yoga, like, how did you get into the yoga thing?
I just ended up. I was always a large fellow myself. I whipped myself into shape 10 years ago and stumbled on it. My first class was free. I was like, I got nothing to lose. I'll try it, and I went in there and enjoyed it.
Does it do wonders for your body?
It does do wonders for my body. I couldn't walk this morning. I went to class. I couldn't walk because of yoga. I went to yoga on Saturday and did like 4 hours in my hips and just my legs are so tight right now. But this morning, I couldn't do shit yesterday. I went to Costco, and if I didn't have a buggy, I'd have never made it. Yeah. I just leaned on the buggy. But I went to class this morning. My legs were tight as hell.
I'm moving around today. I thought I was going to have to phone it in earlier.
But you got into
like,
yoga because of wrestling, right? DDP? Yeah,
well, DDP is what led me to yoga. I seen a video of Chris Jericho was the first one to open my eyes. He fucked his back up, and DDP had him doing it on a tennis court. And then I seen the Scott Hall story, and I was like, that's something to yoga. And if it wasn't for DDP, it would have never happened. I'd have walked by that yoga studio a million times and been like, "That's grandma."
Did you ever write and tell him your story?
I met DDP at one of the Comic Cons, and I told him, and he was like,
"A sick picture."
Yeah, he wanted. He had me email him, and he was like, "We're gonna put it on there," and I'm like, "Are you?" Like, I was like,
"Did he?"
No, he didn't.
There's a local guy he has, but the local guy like goes to a studio. And but
I met him at Comic Con. He probably shook a million people's hands that day.
I interviewed him for like the manager said it was like gonna be an 8-minute interview. He was so cool. Like, he talked to me for like, it was the year he replaced Flair at the Comic Con.
Yeah,
like he talked to us for about, I don't know. He said he was hungover too from his daughter's wedding the night before.
Love that.
He was late. He was real late to it.
It was like 40 minutes we were on the phone. Like, he just, awesome. He would have just kept going. We were talking about wrestling, the yoga, and then he gave me the free DDP yoga for life.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
And like, I did it like once or twice.
I bring his name up into the yoga community all the time, and people were like, "Who?" And I'm like, "I can't believe you don't know who this man is." I was like, that's the only dude I think of famous wise.
Well, he's like your,
he made it
he's
cool
like the
for
head
guys.
Of your yoga
he's
movement.
He's my guru.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Technically.
He made it cool for guys. Like, yeah, he made it cool. You know, chicks in the yoga pants.
He called it, he marketed it as, he would say, it's not your grandma's yoga.
Yeah.
Or not your mom's yoga or whatever.
You've really taken that to heart. Like,
I did. Yeah. I'm like,
Yeah, for sure.
And he helped so many people. Oh, like, you talk about Scott Hall. He got Jake the Snake clean.
I just watched a video of Buff Bagwell and Scotty Riggs on his page, and not even that. It was just some random dude that was fucked up. A Butterbean.
Yeah.
He brought Butterbean back. Butterbean.
Speaking of jackass,
got Butterbean right so Butterbean could get a surgery. This boy was walking like this. It was the sickest thing I ever seen. Literally from a wheelchair to... Butterbean might knock you out again.
Back
like
to
he got a surgery and he's like moving upright and shit. I watched a good documentary. I think it's like the Redemption of Jake the Snake or whatever.
Yep, it shows.
That's
you
such
program,
a fucking good documentary, and it shows you like what DDP's doing. Like, even if you're not a wrestling fan, if you just everybody got an old uncle that needs a new hip and shit. Just watching him make people do chair yoga and make them believe. Not only does he make them do yoga, he makes them kick drugs and clean eat. And that's my hero.
He's a hell of a guy. Hell of a guy. He doesn't probably get enough credit for it. And I think there's been rumors this year that he's going to get the Warrior Award.
He better get the Warrior Award. He healed more people than anybody.
Yeah, the Warrior Award?
They give the Warrior Award to somebody like that makes a difference in...
Like the NFL Man of the Year equivalent.
Yeah.
Like what they gave dude Cam Hayward or whatever. It's like that, but in wrestling, like in Ultimate Warrior's name, they give somebody like... Every year, who makes it like it's usually impact like ambassadors, global ambassadors.
Yeah,
he should get that. DDP is worthy of all the accolades.
Yeah, I think with all the all the guys in that,
it blows my mind it blows my mind when I bring it up in yoga circles and people are like, "Who the fuck are you talking about?"
Yeah,
and I'm like Diamond Dallas Page. His gimmick was. He was a strip club owner and he had girls, the Diamond Dolls.
Real deal,
that was his gimmick, that he owned a strip club and he had a stable of girls.
That was a real deal. The Diamond Dolls and they were the girls that worked for him, and how he got into wrestling was all the wrestlers would come to his bar in Atlanta.
Yeah, he started wrestling at like 40.
And then they brought him. They started training him. Yeah. And
no way.
Yeah, that was a real deal.
Yeah, I've been watching some of these. What is that? The Biography Channel that I've been sending you on YouTube.
They'll show you. Diamond Dallas will get a biography and it'll be
50-minute biography. Like you're saying, even me, not a wrestling fan, every one of those guys is crazy interesting.
There's crazy stories like that. Like Ric Flair was in a plane crash.
Yeah, he stole his name because the real Ric Flair died next to him. Not Ric Flair, the real Nature Boy or whatever. Yeah.
Stone Cold broke his neck in the ring.
Yeah, Owen Hart broke his neck. That's why they killed Owen. That's my little conspiracy.
Okay. Yeah, all right. When you were talking about Iron Claw, they kind of touched on it in the movie, but Kerry Von Erich wrestled in the WWE with one foot.
That's what when he got his leg, when he chopped his foot off after the motorcycle thing, but nobody knew,
but
right?
Who was Kerry? The Red Rooster?
No, Kerry was the Texas Tornado.
The college Olympian.
The fake Ultimate Warrior.
Yeah.
I ain't seen Iron Claw yet. I know a little bit about the Erichs.
The timelines are off, because like...
what it seemed like when I did research.
They rushed everything. It's like he won the NWA title, and then they made it seem in the movie that like the next day he like... lost his foot in a motorcycle accident, but it was like 2 or 3 years later, and then 2 or 3 years after that, he went to WWE.
And there's like a whole brother they don't even talk about. He wasn't in wrestling or anything. Yep. Like, they definitely took some liberties.
Like MJF was that brother. Yeah. He was in
he gets
movie.
Cut, right? Like, he's in the movie for like a second.
They cut him out. Yeah.
Because that's too, they like created a fake cousin or brother or something at some point.
There was a lot of changes to the original story, but it's cool that like... You know, like people like frowned upon wrestling, and now it's like mainstream. They're doing movies.
Fifth major sport. Almost.
Now they're talking UFC. About Eddie Guerrero next for a movie.
I love Eddie. I got chills. Eddie was my favorite.
Yeah.
I was one of my favorite people growing up.
Yeah, he was
I lie, I cheat, I steal. I fucking loved when he
was his game,
bro. He was a gangster.
I love that.
And Mommy, he had China, he had his girl. Yeah, he'd be like,
now they're kind of doing it with Mysterio's
dude. Game. I love the heat that he gets off topic, like he was saying about like how the crowd is the sickest. The heat that man gets is beautiful.
They don't like him? Is that what that
they
means?
They won't let him talk.
Oh. He's Rey Mysterio's son, who's
he shouldn't be there, and they remind him, but it's like. Them reminding him makes him the hottest heel in the game. Like,
he's
there's
a
no
great
one
worker. He's a great
I appreciate him.
If you break him down and you watch what he does, he's a great worker. Like, even the guys put him over in interviews and stuff. But, like...
I look at him,
he turned on his dad, who's, like, a treasure to the
wrestling
world.
Yeah, I got a picture with Rey Mysterio Jr.
And, like, he turned on his dad. Like, that was, like, the craziest thing ever. Like, no one's seen it.
Yeah.
Coming until it happened, and then they were like, "Oh shit!"
Because Rey Mysterio is like considered like one of the top like athletic
legend,
right? Like
he's
in terms of like wild.
He's like the little man who wrestled
flying all over the place.
Whatever the giant versus the little guy,
David versus Goliath. Yeah.
The original high flyer.
That's awesome.
Him, Eddie, and RVD, the legends.
Oh, well, Todd. Feels like we just talked to a legend for about 40 minutes, man. I feel like we could go for another 90 minutes on your... Well, we're not going anywhere just yet. We're going to do a little beat those cheeks if you're still down to stick around for that. My man. All right.
Anything you need to plug or...
Club Sandwich.
Fire away.
Club Sandwich 412. All of season one is out. It's on all socials. It's just Club Sandwich 412. Club Sandwich 412.com or Oneberg and Oneberg.com. Yeah, check it out. If you like, I kind of say it's kind of like Diners, Drive-Ins, and Dives, but a Yinzer version.
Fuck yeah.
It's so like a What's Good in the Hood. We do something we call What's Good in the Hood. It's similar.
So we'll have to do a collab.
We should.
Maybe we'll go to Yoli's and eat that big...
Go eat a triangle hoagie.
Bring the wing bowl back, baby. Nobody
the wing bowl, that's
idea.
What we're going to do.
We got to have down, a wing I'm competition. I'm down to do anything. This has been great, but I appreciate it. And if you like sandwiches, you like to see about Pittsburgh. There's like a little historical piece that we do. And like, it was funny. We use an AI generator for the narrator.
Nice.
And I named him like Alan Ift or something. People ask me, hey, where's that? What's the Alan look like?
Yeah. Like, well, maybe we got to beat that out so you don't just, you don't sell the secret sauce right there. But no. Oh, all right. Well, let's toss it over to Beat or Beat Those Cheeks. This is dope. All right. So as promised, we are back with the flagship segment. First time in a long time, Ralphie.
Yeah.
Beat or Beat Those Cheeks, where we take suggestions from our listeners, the anybody's, Ralphie, maybe our guests like Double D here, and we debate them. If them things is whack, if you don't like them, Double D, they're beat. If you like it, if you're into it, if it feels just good enough, you're beating those cheeks. So, all right, the first one we're going to start with, I would say, is a pillar of breakfast that we somehow haven't. I think this was submitted way back when, a few months ago. I want to say this is a poop stain submission of Denny's. So I think it's only appropriate we kick it off with our guest, Ralphie. So
yeah.
Double D, are you beat or beating the cheeks of Denny's?
I'm not a breakfast guy. I don't like eggs.
I don't like eggs.
So beat.
Yeah, Ralphie's gonna beat you up.
I'll go eat the appetizer platter.
Okay, so, all right.
For breakfast.
But Double D, I'm joining you. I am also beat on Denny's. I think Denny's is not because I don't like breakfast. I think it's bottom of the barrel chain breakfast restaurant. Give me an Eaton Park. Give me a Perkins. Give me an IHOP. Give me a Waffle House. Give me all of that shit 10 times out of 10 over bunk ass Denny's and their little whack ass Grand Slam smile, whatever the fuck.
Denny, I mean, that's like one fifth of their menu is breakfast. I'm beating the cheeks on Denny's because Denny's was. That was my go-to in high school, in my 20s.
Like late night?
Get drunk and go something about buffalo chicken tenders from Denny's. And their ranch at 11 p.m. is...
I didn't know they had burgers and stuff, to be honest.
Yeah,
it's yeah, a, yeah. I assume they
so
were only
Denny's breakfast, for me, is beat.
It's
beat.
Probably yeah. way too greasy but for me.
Everything else is cheeks.
Okay, yeah. you're beating the cheeks of like the post 11 a.m. menu, I guess, is the best way to put that.
Yeah, Denny's got normal, they got turkey sandwiches and shit like that.
You telling me they got a salad bar?
No, they don't got a salad bar.
They ain't got no Eaton Park salad
well,
bar.
Well, they're
no
not.
Smiley cookie.
I was going to say side talk, there's Eaton Park all day over Denny's, though, if we're picking one.
Well, I guess maybe we could do a little, what is your favorite, if we are approaching this from, like, the breakfast angle, which I guess is going to be hard for you, Double D, if you don't like breakfast, but if you had to pick one breakfast chain, where are you going?
I like the sausage muffin every morning. Like, get a cup, four of those in the morning.
I like that. I like that.
And, a caramel frappe.
A caramel frappe. I've never had.
Oh, it's frozen. It's delicious.
Yeah, that sounds up your alley. I know you're not a caffeine guy, but if you're gonna drink caffeine, you might as well put some sugar in it for you.
Yeah.
What's your favorite breakfast chain? Denny's, it sounds like. No, Eaton Park, you said.
I'm guessing Eaton Park. I don't really like any of those technically either for breakfast. My breakfast spot that I would normally go to is a Square Cafe, which I don't even know if it's still the Square Cafe over in Swissville.
Wow, look at you.
Yeah, there's no.
That's fancier than I thought you would have been.
Well, no, they, when I discovered it, I was on a health food craze and I knew they had gluten-free pancakes and shit like that. Yep. I would go up, but I eat gluten. I like it. At the time I was a big coffee drinker and they're home of the big cup. They give you a big cup of coffee and their coffee was good. But coming from McKeesport, there ain't, we got Eaton Park. That's fucking it. If you want breakfast,
we had Eaton Park. We had the IHOP down by the waterfront. And then we had like local diners, which is like there's one on the north side I go to Sunday mornings. Lindo's, shout out Lindo's, still do the buffet. But yeah, we had a lot of like one-off Greasy Spoons. Ritter's, it was our drunk diner
Tom's
when we were kids.
Diner.
Tom, down here, when it was open down here.
Yeah, I go to Dormont. I was on from this side of town.
Okay.
So.
Right. Pamela's is really good too.
Yeah.
But that's, you got to wait, man.
See, Pamela's to me is like...
Yeah, that pancake diner.
That's like that's almost like, that's not a diner to me. I know that sounds crazy. Pamela's is more of a restaurant.
Yeah, right.
It is a tourist trap.
It reminds
me. We get it. Obama went there. Give it a rest.
Did he?
Yeah. Oh, you never knew. How did that?
What did he get?
Not elected.
No, he got elected.
Yeah.
If he could do it again, he'd do it again.
Yeah.
All right. So let's move on to the next one here. Ralphie, maybe I'll start off with you on this one because this one is kind of is really on brand for you. Overhead lighting, also from Poop Stain. Are you beat or beating the cheeks?
I'm beat on overhead lighting. Turn a lamp on. You just need a little bit of lighting. I don't like LED lights either. We'll throw that on top of it.
On cars and houses in general?
Yep, I don't like them.
They're so much more sustainable. That's right up your alley.
Are they?
LED? Oh, way more than incandescent, for sure.
When you say sustainable, you just mean they last a little bit longer and are...
Like a lot longer, and I think they're made out of better material. Like,
they'll outlast us because they're killing us.
Okay, all right. We've gotten to conspiracy
LED,
portion.
LED lights are like one of the worst things for you. Like,
really? What about the colored ones that I have behind my TV?
I was just going to say, you don't remember Richard with the blue lights and the red light? Red light at night, you'll be all right. Blue light in the morning.
I thought that was like with the sky, red light at night, sailor's delight.
In your house, like, if you've ever, there's studies like about like watching TV, things like that before you go to bed. That's blue light right there. That's the worst thing for you at night.
Well, I read something that I didn't read, it was on Instagram, like a ship, like a deadliest catch type ship that the guy was on. Yeah. And he said that if you ever notice in the captain's quarters, the light's always red. That helps you adjust to night vision.
Yeah.
So it's not just like a bright light.
You're able
like
to see, you're able to see a little bit better in red light. Me and Richard had big discussions on that.
Todd, where you at on overhead lighting?
Well, what's the setting? Like your house?
Yeah.
Like I'll walk in my bedroom. I'll hit the switch to turn on the ceiling fan.
I'll go lamp in a house, but depending on maybe upstairs, maybe in the game room, down the man cave, maybe some.
So you got different ambiances all over the crib. It sounds like yeah. I like that. Well, this is absolutely. I'm beat on overhead lighting. I guess just in general. I also am a lamp or a star lamp type of guy that we got at the flea market, which just reminded me, Todd, we got to go on a little tangent here if you don't mind. So just to give you some context, last year, two summers ago,
I already know we threw it. I was sad about it too.
Bro, what?
If it wasn't his birthday,
I almost drove up there and wrung his neck.
I'll help you out and say I bought it.
Okay, because all right, thank you.
Motherfucker.
We threw a tailgate with Yoli's on Father's Day 2 years ago, and we made these shirts when Vogelbach was on the team. We loved Vogelbach, like obviously big
made
dude.
A big sandwich. Called it the Vogel Bomb.
Like went impossible all in to on eat. It. Benny made t-shirts that said the Vogel Bomb.
It's the hardest shirt we ever made.
Ralph.
I go up to the flea market yesterday and Jeff Mervis has a booth up there. I'm looking at his dollar table and he's selling his fucking Vogel Bomb shirt.
That came with his ticket last year.
That came with his ticket.
So
I was like, that's a sentimental thing. I was like, we made that and it's a hard design. He's like, he don't play for the team no more. I'm like, this is the team.
We needed something to spice up the show now. I didn't think it was a new mortal enemy from a former friend, which is like, Merv, I love you. You're dead to me, I think.
Get that.
Yeah.
Artificial intelligence.
What is it? This?
Fucking thing out of here.
Get out of here. That's what I think about that. Yeah, absolutely. Merv, you're dead to me.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Benny sent me the crying emo.
Laughing or real crying?
Real crying. Yeah, and I was like, I know. It's a bad day for anybody.
Could you imagine your homeboy just went and sold a club sandwich shirt for $1 at the flea market? It would be devastating.
Yeah.
At least mark us up for like $5.
I should have been on a $5 table.
I'm blocking you on Facebook.
Yeah, see, now club sandwich is also anti-Jeff.
He'll never get a shirt again.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Let's move on to the last one here that Double D actually brought to us. So we're going to let you lead this one off. Are you beat or beat in the cheeks of, I guess, this time of year, St. Patrick's Day, maybe summertime, hot dogs becoming a little bit more sauerkraut is what you wanted to bring to the... Okay. All right. You're doing...
Beat.
Just never been for you? You had a bad experience?
The smell, the taste, like I'm just not... It's in the name, sour. It's not a kraut. It's not an appealing name.
Yeah. Kraut, if it was kraut. 1950, also not
He's
appealing.
He's got sauerkraut down here.
Yeah. See, this is something that I used to be as beat as you could be on, and I've grown into beating the cheeks on it in very certain situations. Like, I only eat it on a hot dog at the baseball game. Like, I'm never buying it. It's
what
never
about
at
kielbasa?
My crib.
With kielbasa.
Yeah, I get so like any type of vessel like that. I do it on a hot dog, a kielbasa, a sausage, like at like an event. I'm never like when I make hot dogs at home. Say again,
wiener shaped foods.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, I know you're averse to that. Me, all in. Give me all the dick shaped foods.
I mean, I'll eat those foods. I just don't want to eat a large.
I eat bananas. We'll keep it at that.
What did he say in Superbad? He goes, "Do you know how many foods are shaped like dicks? The best kinds." Like, yeah.
I'm beat as beat can be on sauerkraut as well. Yeah,
you don't have many things you don't like.
One of them is sauerkraut. I don't like sauerkraut. I don't like mushrooms really, but I
like
force
kimchi?
Myself. I've never had it.
Really?
I'm assuming that I might not like it since I don't like sauerkraut.
It's made with a fruit though, right? It's
Kimchi?
Kimchi.
No, that's cabbage too. Cabbage. It's just like Asian seasonings instead of like German or Dutch seasonings, I guess. But yeah, there's some more like, I think there's like, I'm going to say all this stuff wrong. Maybe some carrots. Is daigon a vegetable?
Never heard of it.
Talking to the wrong crew.
So like, I made the joke at one point.
Like Star Trek talk.
I don't think any of us have had a vegetable in a long time. But except for Ralph. Ralph eats a bag of spinach raw by hand every day.
I eat a quarter pound of spinach every day.
yeah, quops of spinach.
I like broccoli.
Okay.
I like broccoli too. Guy. We had a guest on here who was talking big shit on broccoli in December, and I stopped eating broccoli, and I went to Costco yesterday and bought a big bag. That's what I'm going home to eat.
I got to tell you, the broccoli. Taylor Farms one?
Yeah.
I got that today. Yeah, you come to the house. I'll save you a trip. Yeah.
I got it already. It's just fucking big. I buy one. I used to buy one once a week.
Todd, this was awesome, dude. I hope you had as much fun as we did.
Anytime.
We are some kindred souls around here.
You only eat sauerkraut on hot dogs. You don't eat. You strike me as a New Year's
pork. No, very Irish, dude. That's not Italian at all.
Did you guys ever touch on this on the show? Pineapple on pizza.
This was somebody came in crazy adamant about this.
That fucking Sean from Slice of New York. He hates ranch on pizza. I like ranch on, I like
the crust.
Crust, yeah. I just like ranch in general, but I think pineapple on pizza is not bad. My mom used to, when I used to be in my ham days when I was little, my mom would get a Hawaiian pizza from Mama Pepino's.
Yeah.
It fucking hit ham, pineapple with, it would be a little soggy because the pineapple juice, but it honestly, I didn't mind it.
To me, it's like, I really don't get why it's so divisive. Like, to me, it's just like, it is what it is. Like, people, I look at it the same as beef.
It's just not.
What about like sardines? Are you into that?
I used to be a sardine kid. I haven't had one in 20 years. We had anchovies when we went to Minio's.
I might start chirping people and just calling them sardines. Like when I want to make fun of somebody, just like, you're a fucking sardine, bro. You in on that?
Yeah, you little...
Ken Pickett didn't work, maybe. I wanted to start calling Kenny Ken Pickett to, like, motivate him.
Yeah.
To, like, be like, all right, we got to, like, this isn't college anymore. We got to take this a little more serious. Like,
yeah.
And didn't seem to
call him by his... Call him Kenneth. Yeah. Call him his mom.
Yeah.
Kenneth, get your head out of your ass.
Call him Ken Roethlisberger.
Get you Yeah.
Todd, this is great, dude. We're going to link up, hopefully, again soon. I think we did all the plugs. You did your plugs.
We got to organize a wing fest.
Wing Bowl coming soon, 2024. I love that. All right. Well, see you next week.
Peace out.
Peace out.